Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, the scripture that we should all know is say, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. We said earlier on today about Jesus Christ telling Peter, said, I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom. And once there are keys, that means there are doors. There is a door for every blessing. And there's a key that opens it. I pray the Lord will give you the key.
Yeah.
So ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. So Jesus gave a promise. He promised to answer prayer. See? One, ask, it will be given. Two, seek, you will find. Three, knock, it will be opened. And who was this promise for?
For us.
Verse 8 tells us, for everyone who asks, receives. So who was this promise for?
Everyone
who asks, receives. So as it stands, the promise is for everyone. Everyone who asks, receives. So if you notice the tense, it's a present tense. Everyone who asks, receives. That is, everyone who keep asking, keep receiving. So with this understanding in the mind, therefore, if you apply the same rule to that verse 8, it will read like this. For everyone who keep asking, keep receiving. And he who keep seeking, keep finding. And to him who keep knocking, it will be opened.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the promise is for everyone.
Yes.
Everyone has a role. Everyone has a duty of care to enjoy the promise. Everyone. And what is the duty of care? For everyone, number one, keep asking. Number two, keep seeking. Number three, keep knocking. Don't say, I have prayed and the Lord has not heard me. He said, keep asking, keep seeking, and keep knocking. For everyone who keep asking, keep receiving. And he who keep seeking, keep finding. And he who keep knocking, it will be open. That's the promise of God. But not without your duty of care. From God's point of view, if everyone carry out their duties of care, God will respond to their prayers. God will not deny them. If no one will do what anyone should do, someone must do what everyone ought to do. I'm using the keyword there, no one, anyone, someone, and everyone. So keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. Verse 9 to 10, verses 9 to 10. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? It's important, the symbols that is used in biblical times. Bread and stone. Fish and
serpent.
And is it not interesting also, when Jesus, led by the Spirit of God, where he was led into the wilderness, and he defeated Satan, in that spiritual warfare of his mind, what was the question that was thrown at Jesus by Satan? He said, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. And that was exactly what Jesus was saying at the Mount of this Mount of Beatitudes, Sermon on the Beatitudes. That was saying that there, that who among you, if your son should ask you of bread, for a bread, will you give him a stone? What's the importance of that one? He's explaining to us, as bread is good because it is food, but in life, in our relationships with God, the Word of God becomes our spiritual bread. Natural food has a limited role compared to spiritual food. So in your spiritual walk with God, let the Word of God be paramount. The paramount, not bread. Not what you eat or what you put on. God wants His Word to rule our lives. Do you get the picture? It's not about food. It's not about bread. It's about the spiritual bread. The one that came from heaven. Jesus. It's about the Word of God. Jesus answered and said to him, "It is written." So that tells us that if we know what has been written by God, that is enough to overcome every attack that the enemy throws at us. Verse 11. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask Him? This is food for thought. He said, if men who are evil know how to give good things, God can go over and beyond. He said, how much more your Father that is in heaven give good things to those who ask Him? So don't ask. Don't stop asking God for good things. Because He can give you much more. Amen. Don't say, I don't know whether it's the will of God for me to get this job. I don't know whether it's the will of God for me to say yes to this employment. Why not? Is that not a good gift? Yes. So if God will give good things to those who keep asking Him, how come good things sometimes don't come? Some people say, "Amen." I wasn't praying. I'm asking a question. I said, if God will give much more, give good things to those who ask, how come sometimes we don't get good things when we ask? Is that a valid question? Is somebody here?
Yes.
How come good things sometimes don't come when we ask? In that time that we ask. How come some things get delayed in coming? Delay or denial? God is never late. However, He allows delays to happen sometimes. We discussed this last week, didn't we? John 11, verses 5 to 7. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, who was sick?
Lazarus.
He stayed 2 more days. That sounds like a delay, isn't it? He delayed in his coming. Yes. He stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." Look at verses 14 to 15. Then Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead." Because all along he was in talk using symbolic time. Lazarus was sleeping. He's sleeping. Then Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. I am glad that for your sake that I was not there when it happened. So he deliberately stated two models for their sins. But why? Why did he state two models? He said that they may believe. Did he get his answers there? That they may believe. So delay is not a denial. But delay is there so that you believe God, isn't it?
Yes.
So it is true, God promised, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock. Yes. It is equally true that in giving us good things, he will take his time. So if you can agree with that, that he has made a promise, isn't it? And as a duty of care for everyone that believes what they are, what they are to do, isn't it? So, delay is not a denial for any believer. Because you're patient in the trial. So during this time, we may consider it as a delay, but really it's not a delay because God has his own time. So in these scriptures that we've been reading, and in the Bible times, I come up with, I discovered two types of delays really that can happen in prayers. Or your answers to prayers. Like this one, it was not really a delay, but it was the appropriate timing of God, isn't it? So I would say there are two types, the good one and the bad one. Like this Lazarus death. When Jesus Christ heard about it, Jesus Christ said, I deliberately stayed behind for your sake so that you believe. So, in the eye of man, which you will soon find out in the words of Martha and Mary, they said, if you have been here, if you have been here, they said, Lazarus will not have died. That was a delay to them, wasn't the case? But God deliberately stayed two more days for the disciples that followed him to believe. So when you are, as a believer, believing God for his promise, especially when he has given you a blank check, ask and you shall receive. Seek
and
knock. That's a blank check, isn't it?
Right.
He doesn't say whatever, anyone, everyone will ask, will keep asking, will receive. And everyone will keep seeking, will find, and everyone will keep knocking. The door will be open. That's a blank check, isn't it? But you have to know that God will take his time. So when you call it a delay, it's a good delay, isn't it? That's the first time. So ask yourself, is this a delay or denial? When Jesus heard that, let's look at that, the first one. The first type of delay, the one I call the good delay, which is the perfect time of God, which actually is no delay because God has to take his time. But in the eye of man, it's a delay. But you have to ask yourself, is it delay or denial? In verse 1 of John 11, verse 2, verse 3, and verse 4, Lazarus was sick. When Jesus heard, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. So why you call it a delay? God is looking for opportunity for his Son to be glorified through it. So give him a chance and keep asking. keep seeking and keep knocking. Don't be overwhelmed by the material gain. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
So the perfect time of God will allow Jesus to be glorified through your problem. That's why I call it a good delay. And this explains the reason for this kind of delay. Look at verses 11 and 12. These things he said, and after he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. They did not understand the symbol. So when you open the scripture, God speaks in symbolic terms. He uses natural things to explain the spiritual world. And when he says someone is sleeping, he says that means the person has died. But he said there that because they did not understand it, later on he now spoke to them clearly that Lazarus has died. And you see there that from the verses that I've read to you, he was sick. And later on, he understood that he actually died. Mm-hmm. It's still the perfect timing of God, isn't it? Mm-hmm. For things to get worse from that. But you have to understand that he has given you a gram check. So why are you afraid of the situation becoming worse from the bad situation? Am I talking to somebody?
Yeah.
So you have to understand what is happening here. You see, God allowed this. He was still looking for the perfect time for Jesus to be glorified, even though the situation was getting worse. So if you are a believer, therefore, don't look at circumstances to justify who God is. God is already God. The situation will eventually answer to God at the end. Ask yourself, is it delay or denial? Another example is Abraham and Sarah's family. Hear what he said and what was in his mind, his reaction. When the news was said to him, when God broke the news to him that he will have a son, Genesis 17, verse 17. Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, he was thinking of it. He was thinking about this. You two might be thinking about this. So when you are thinking and you are not voicing it out, you are saying it in your heart. And God sees what you are saying in your heart. Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? He was thinking in his heart. When God told him he was going to become a father. So in God's view, the deal is done because God has already made it for us. That's another blank check. So whatever you are asking the Lord for, provided it is in the will of God, it's a blank check. The deal is done. In the eyes of God, the deal is done. But is it done in your own eyes? But there is more work for Abraham to be done. There is more work for Abraham to do, rather, because he said in his heart, how can or shall a 100-year-old man have a son? Even though God told him he was going to have a son. So when that situation comes, arrives at your doorpost, and you know it's the will of God for you to prosper, you don't keep doubting and keep questioning, how shall this be? When Mary asked the same question, how shall this be, since I do not know a man? The angel told her, said, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. The power of the Almighty shall overshadow you. And the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. Isn't it? And this thing came to pass. So what we are saying in effect is, when God gives a blank check, He expects you to see that it's a done deal. But your patience will be tried and your faith will be tried. When you don't take your focus away from the promises of God, you keep serving Him because God will never fail. So if you know that God will never fail in this matter, in this situation of my own life, God will not fail. Well, it's up to you. Let's see if He will not fail or not. So how long can you hold on to that faith? Keep serving Him. Keep serving Him. Keep serving Him. Keep serving Him. Don't look at that thing. Look at Jesus. Keep serving Him. And at the end, He will laugh last. I said He will laugh last. So in Romans chapter 4, verses 21 to 22, talking about Abraham and Sarah's family, when God had told them, particularly told him, Abraham, that he will become the father, he was going to have a son. And being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. And therefore, as a result of carrying out their both duties of care, Abraham and Sarah, it was accounted to him for righteousness. God counted what Abraham did as being right. Because Abraham believed God. He was convinced that what God has promised, God is also able to perform. Is that your own conviction? If that is your own conviction, or whatever you are asking the Lord for, and you keep asking, He will do it. But it will take His time. Are you ready to wait? They that wait upon the Lord shall do what? Renew their strength. What that means is that you don't wane in your trust. You wax in your strength, in your trust. That's not the time to stop praying. That's not the time to stop coming for prayer meeting. That's not the time to stop coming to church. Amen. Because He's watching. That's why you must keep asking. Every opportunity to remind Him of His word, you must keep asking, keep seeking, and keep knocking. And eventually, the door will open. Is it delay or denial? Moving on from the first type of delay that I find out, which is a good delay, it's a good problem, because eventually it's a done deal. The second one is a bad one, which I want us to pay attention to. And this second one has something to do with satanic involvement. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 to 4, are you with me? Are you with me?
Yes.
For though we walk in the flesh, verse 3, we do not walk according to the flesh. Can you see that we are involved in the warfare? If you are a believer, there are thousands and more reasons the devil has against us for you not to enter into your fulfillment. But he is a failure. He has already failed.
Amen.
But nothing can stop you from entering into your destiny. So who is he that seeth a thing and cometh to pass when the Lord has not commanded it? So it's only what God has commanded that will come to pass. So what can separate us from the love of Christ? Shall this, shall that? You see? So in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Amen. He was only talking to believers. Those people that have seen that it's a done deal, that open check that God has given, and they are ready to wait for it. But they that wait upon the Lord renew their strength. So the time that you call a delay is a strength renewal period. The time you call a delay is for you to renew your strength. And that's what we're talking about, the month of resilience. It's for you to bounce back. It's for you never to take no for an answer. Just because it has not yet happened doesn't mean it will not happen. It's up to you. So this second delay, which is a bad one, the Bible says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. So whether you believe it or not, you are already in the warfare because you say you are a Christian. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they are not physical, they are not man-made, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. So this type of delay will require someone with understanding to use spiritual weapons to fight in the warfare. The disciples of Jesus Christ came to him like, why couldn't we cast out the demons? Jesus Christ said, this kind, everyone says this kind, this kind does not go except by prayer and fasting. So this type of delay will require you, someone with spiritual understanding, to use spiritual weapons to win this war. This one is not for people that are in and out of the church, in and out of their relationship with God. These are for people that are ready to stand in the gap and make sure that the will of God is done. So it's not everyone that understands the spiritual warfare. It's not everyone that knows, understands the second type of delays that can happen in your answers to your prayers, unless you are taught and you are equipped. That's why Paul said in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. For verse 12 said, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities and powers, rulers of darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. So he implores you to be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. Don't take your Christianity lightly. Don't take your spirituality lightly. Don't take your relationship with God lightly. So this second type of delays that can happen when you are waiting for the answer to come, remember, it's a satanic encounter that can impede, delay the answers to the prayers. But you don't take your focus away from God. Because remember, it's an open church. God now, God has already paid it. He has paid the price. Hallelujah. For you, so that you will laugh last. And you will laugh last. The delay as a result of satanic encounter arises when Satan gets the advantage or wants to get the advantage. And that's why Paul warns us in 2 Corinthians 2, verse 11, lest Satan take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. One of his devices is to send friends and families to you and say, why must you continue to go to this church? Don't you hear? Don't you see what is happening? If God can answer your prayer, he would have done it. Why don't you do what other people are doing? Everyone help those who help themselves. Where is that in the Bible? You see? No. It's only God that can help you. You see, when, and that's why David, David said, my help comes from the Lord. See, So when you walk with the Lord, you learn to trust Him. Don't listen to what your friends are saying. Your friends have already missed it. And they are looking for people to miss it with them. If that makes sense. We can only look at people that have already made it in life. And then you listen to what they are saying. One of my mentors said, there are two types of people that we can learn from. Those people that have made it and those people that have failed. Even those people that have failed, you know, if they have failed and they have learned from it, they are in a position to teach them. But the people that have failed and they keep failing and they still don't know that they are failing, they are already going down. Why would you want to go down? So look at the people giving you instruction. Look at their lifestyle. Look at their spirituality with God. Do they have genuine testimonies in their lives? Or they are just church hopping? Or they are looking for people to derail, to derail as they have been derailed? The blind leading the blind. So you are hearing this if your opportunity to want this, for your life to be made better. Ask yourself, why is this a delay or denial? I'm taking my time to explain to you that it is true that there is no delay in God. But it's also equally true that there can be denials. Especially when you are asking God to do what is not in His will. He will deny you. We have said there is delay, but there is no denial. There could be a denial when you are asking God to do against His will. Do you hear me well?
Yes.
So, don't let Satan take advantage of us. Unconfessed sins, devil will hold on to it. And will use that against you. Do you know that the devil is called the accuser of the brethren? Why are you giving him fuel? Why are you giving him ammunition? Why are you giving him the ammunition to use? Because of your unconfessed sin. And this can bring a delay. Even a long delay. Unconfessed sin. Sinful practice. Serious sins of our lives will give the devil an advantage to afflict us, even though we are believers, to bring delays in answers to our prayers. Look, for example, there's a scripture, Daniel chapter 9. Israel was taken into captivity once in Egypt, remember, and God delivered them through the hands of Moses. But they didn't learn from experience. Bible says, English says, history repeats itself. Do you know why history repeats itself? It's because people never learned from the previous one. And so they keep repeating the same class. Men begin to abuse them. Because they didn't learn from the last relationship that failed. But if they have learned, and they have known that only God can help me, God, I'm going to serve you. I'm not going to allow anyone to abuse my virginity. I'm going to serve you until the right man comes, until the right woman comes. Wow. That's holy before God. He said, be you holy as I am holy. So, once you find God in that way, God knows that you are trusting Him. God knows everyone that is trusting Him. And He knows those who are not trusting Him. So, if He knows that you are trusting Him, He will answer you. Remember, yours might just be the first delay, the good one. Because God is looking for opportunity for Jesus to be glorified. And once you find the right time, you will see. Even your critics, they will come to God.
Amen.
Through you. Is that not a good glory? Come on, give Jesus a round of applause. That's what we're talking about. It's not about you. Even even though you are the one suffering. It's about the will of God to be done, so that God can bring other sufferers like him into glory. So ask yourself, is this a delay or denial? Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed, Jesus Christ, remains in him. And he cannot sin because he has been born of God. That's what Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Because Christ is living in you and I, if you are born again, you cannot sin. What that means is that sin does not have dominion over you anymore. You don't have the nature of sin anymore. Now, when you told a lie, is that not a sin? It's a sin. But the moment you told a lie, you knew it was a sin. And what did you see? What did you do? Lord, I am sorry. I shouldn't have said this. So you have the power not to sin. Next time God will give you opportunity, will you tell the same lie? Even if you told the same lie, you knew that it was a sin. It's just a matter of you not growing up as a child of God. You are still disobedient to God. Not that you don't know what to do. Some will say, oh, I cannot help it. You can help it if you are born again, child of God. Now, that's what it means, that the seed of God is in him, so you cannot sin. In other words, you are not subject to sin anymore. Sin is no longer your Lord and Master. Who is now your Lord and Master? Christ. So even if you now do something that is wrong, we have an advocate with the Father. That's, I'm sorry, Lord. I shouldn't have done this. Please forgive me. And if you are genuinely repented, if you have genuinely repented, you find out that he gives you the grace. He makes more grace available to the humble. But if you are just saying it, I'm sorry, and you are still going back to it, then you have not known the truth. All confessed sins will not only bring the name, it will deny you of the Lord's blessings. And in that Daniel chapter 9, Daniel saw a vision about the kingdom and the place of Israel in all this. He knew that God brought them out of Egypt, but now they are in another captivity in Babylon. God showed him the duration of how long Jerusalem will lay in ruin. 70 years. Verse 20. Now, while I was speaking, praying, and confessing my sin, did you see what he did? Confessing the sin of not only him, but the sin of his nation. And the sin of my people Israel. Daniel confessed their sins and the sins of everyone, and ask God for forgiveness. And look at what happened in response. God sent his holy angel to anoint Daniel. Or hear the message in part that the angel Gabriel brought to Daniel. Daniel chapter 10, verses 10 to 14. Are you with me?
Yes.
We are looking at what brought delay in the answers that Daniel wanted from the Lord. Verse 10. Suddenly, a hand touched me, which made me tremble on my knees and on the palms of my hands. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright. For I have now been sent to you. I have now been sent to you. There was a delay there. I have now been sent to you. While he was speaking this word to me, I stood trembling. Then he said to me, do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. God will come because of it.
Amen.
That's an answer to prayer. But what took him long? Let's find out. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. Was that not a delay? In the answer to the prayer? But Daniel persisted. Daniel was resilient. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. These ones are the enemies of the Lord. These were the spiritual principalities and power in the spiritual atmosphere that withstood the angel of God. But from the first day that Daniel began to pray until 21 days, right, the answer has been given from the first day. So it is true. For everyone that asks, receives. For everyone that seeks, they find. For everyone that knocks, the door is open. And the reason why it will appear as if this thing do not come the moment you ask is because of delays. But you have to understand what goes on in the spiritual atmosphere and keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. Don't take the lazy man's approach and say, maybe God doesn't want me to prosper. It is not true. Don't say, maybe God doesn't want me to marry. It is not true. Don't say it. The reason why you are saying it is because you don't know the truth. If you know the truth shall make you free. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Is it delay or denial? Yes, it is true. Delays are not denials. But equally true, as I've said earlier, even God will deny you his blessings if you are unrepentant. 2 Chronicles, as I begin to round up, chapter 7, verse 14. Did you get something out of it?
Yes.
If my people, he wasn't talking to everyone, he was talking to my people. If you are his people, listen to it. If my people who are called by my name, the people of God are called by his name. That's why whatever you bind here on earth is bound in heaven. Because you are the little him that is here. And whatever the little him does here has the approval from the big one up there. Hallelujah. So that's why you must keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. For sooner, the door that you want to be opened shall be opened. Because faithful is he that keeps the door. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, you will know those people that are called by his name by their humility. If my people that are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. When we pray, we are not only asking, we are also seeking and knocking. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, number one, you need humility to bring yourself low. That God, let your will be done in my life. Not as I will, but let your will be done. It's called broken hearted. It's called contrite spirit. If my people who are called by my name will pray, will humble themselves, seek my face, pray, and then turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from them. I will forgive their sins. If the sin is still there, sin will bring delay, unnecessary delays in your answers to your prayers. Will seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven. You see, some people will pray, God, I don't want to sin anymore. Please forgive me. But you know, they're just praying. They have not turned. You need to turn 360 degrees, isn't it? Turn from it. Amen. Stop those evil friendships. Stop those evil associations. Even though they go to church. What the vibes that is coming out of them? The life. I mean, the lifestyle that is coming out of them is nothing but. So why do you continue to go with them? See? So God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear. Your prayers will be heard when you do what is your duty of care. Your prayers will be heard when you turn from the wicked ways. We cannot continue to in sin and want the grace to abound. God forbid. How shall we that have died to sin continue to live forever? Today, people don't talk. They don't talk more about sin because they know that when you start preaching against sin, people will stop coming to church. But I'd rather talk against sin because I want God. I don't want God to leave me. People might leave me, but not God. Amen? After all, whose church is it? God's church. I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not prevail. The pastor is not the one building church. Neither is it the Pope or the Bishop. God is the builder. Jesus is the builder. He said, I will build my church. The church can only be built upon the foundation of the truth. The church cannot be built upon hypocrisy. So if you don't like the truth, if they don't speak the truth in your church, that's not church. A church is a place where they tell the truth. And you take it. It's not the way you argue it. You don't argue the truth. You can only know the truth, or you don't know the truth. So you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So if my people that are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and talk from their wicked ways, then I will hear from them. I will heal their life. I will forgive their sins. Easy. Amen?
Amen.
The reason why there is no healing is because there is no repentance. If you are genuinely repented, and you are not healed, then God is a liar.
Mm.
But can God lie?
No.
Every evil that man does, he knows it. Mm. You don't need a prophet to tell you. You know it. So when you stop from your heart, I want to start obeying God, he will hear you. Because he heard me. If God has a duty of care to answer prayers, we must exercise faith in our own duties of care to ask him in prayers. There are no deniers in God if you repent. But if not, God himself will deny you of his blessings. Jesus said in Matthew 7, I'll round off with that. Verses 21 to 23. Are you with me?
Yes.
If you are with me, say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Uh-huh.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Amen. Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Can you see what is happening? That God can allow you to cast out demons in his name, to prophesy in his name, to do many wonders in his name, even though you don't know him as your Lord. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name. So, don't approve a man because he cast out demons in the name of Jesus to say that it belongs to Jesus, even though his lifestyle is different from that of Jesus. Until his lifestyle falls in line with the lifestyle of Jesus, then you take him as genuine. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Depart from me, the King James Bible says, depart from me, you that walk iniquity. Is it delay or denial? What you are asking God for, is it delay or denial? Let us pray. With every eyes closed, with every head bowed, the answer is being told. You've been given the answer. God is just expecting you whether you will repent, that you will not be denied. So, I'm waiting for you to do what is expected of you. Repent and turn from your wickedness, and then God will hear your prayers. Will heal you and forgive you. Yeah, talk to him. This is where the buck stops. People have said that maybe this misfortune is the will of God for you. I've come to say no, it's not the will of God for you. The will of God for you is fortune. And you are the only one that can stop it, the misfortune. When you come to God, pray for your children. Pray for the way God wants in the family. Pray for everything that has made or is making your life miserable. That is not the will of God. Ask the Lord to show you His will. Ask the Lord that you want to Him to help you. David came to the Lord, said, my help comes from the Lord. That makes the heavens and the earth. My help does not come from the mountains. Do I look to the mountain? But my help comes from the Lord. Make that God your helper. Ask him, is there balm in Gilead? Can you help me, Lord? These 1, 2, 3 are the problems of my life. And you said, ask and you shall receive. Keep asking and you shall receive. For everyone that keep asking, receives. Everyone that keeps seeking, they find. Everyone that keep knocking, the door is open. Jehovah, I want this door to be open for me. What should I do? I'm sorry for my sin. All of it. From today, I genuinely ask you to forgive me. Because I want to make it to heaven. I want to delight myself in you. And I want you to delight yourself in me. Jehovah, help me. Forgive me. I stand upon your word. I want to be your people. I want to know you. I want to be called by your name. What must I do? From today, I surrender to you. I give you my heart. And I ask you, give me your heart. You promise that you will give me a new heart and a new spirit, so that I will be able to walk in your dictates. Jehovah, help me. You are a boy, you are a girl out there. You are a youth. You are not too young to make it to heaven. You are an adult. Older. You are not too old to serve the Lord. The reason why you are still around is because God wants you to know this truth. Why don't you ask him to forgive you of your sins? They are flashing back into your mind now. Ask him, every one of them, confess them before him. Don't allow the enemy to take advantage of you. Ask him to forgive you of your sin and ask him to be your Lord and Master. Say, this Jesus, both Jesus has become Lord and Savior. This Jesus has become both Lord and Savior. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior. Say his name. Jesus asked, who do men say I am? He turned to the disciples, who do you say I am? Peter said, I know you are the Christ. There is no other Christ, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Living God, because all other gods are not living. This one is living. You are the Son of that living God. Make the Son of the living God to be alive in you. Ask Him to be your Lord and Savior. Ask Him to save you. Anyone, everyone, ask Him to save you. Ask Him to save you. Save your marriage. Save your health. Save your household. Save your career. Save everything that is tinkering, that is falling apart. Let Him save it. Save your church. Save your ministry. He can, if you ask Him. Is it delay or denial? Ask Him to come into your heart and save you. From now on, ask Him to plant you in His church, in His body. Ask Him to plant you in His body. Because He has set every member in that body as He pleases. If He set you in that body, He will give you a role to do. Begin to thank Him. Begin to thank Him. Begin to thank Him. Lord will bless you. Give you praise. So Father, we thank You for Your goodness, for Your kindness. So whoever comes to You, you will no wise cast away. For everyone here and out there that have genuinely repented and want to be saved, please save them. For everyone that have genuinely repented and want You and have asked You to be their Lord and Savior, save them. For everyone, oh God, that will genuinely want to grow in grace, want to serve You really, genuinely, Jehovah, You say, will no wise turn them away. Please don't turn them away. Save us. That which has been a delay, that which has caused a delay, it answers to our prayers. Because we're in agreement with You right now. Remove every delay. Bring them, bring every blessing, bring them to pass. Steady and speedy. In the name of Jesus. In Your own time. We thank You, God. For as many that have turned to You. Say, when we turn to the Lord, the veil shall be removed. Let the veil in our heart be removed. As we turn to You. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Come on, clap those hands together for the Lord. Amen.
Penetrated the bone and the marrow. Amen. I want to encourage us to take it home and just reflect on it. The pastor said so many things, and we need to begin to see in that perspective. You know, when there is delay, is it because God intended it? Is it because of demonic activity? When there is denial, is it because of unconfessed sin? So let's just take it back home and reflect on it. Amen.
It's time to give our offering to the Lord.